Fry 2020, here we come!
Stop! I am Corona! And Pride is canceled!
Oh, no, it's not.
Uh-huh.
I know just who to call.
Pride is about loving yourself.
Respect one another, love one another.
And now we're celebrating a little bit differently, but the message is still the same.
Share love, give love, and be loved.
We will continue to find ways to celebrate our pride.
It doesn't matter where you are in the world.
Liefde is liefde.
Our community is strong.
Wave your pride flag. Love who you are.
Stay safe.
Let's spread the love.
Hey, happy pride.
Feliz orgullo.
Happy pride.
Happy pride, everybody.
Happy pride.
You are beautiful, you are perfect, and you are loved.
Morning Mission Gathering. We are here in Hillcrest at the Pride Flag. We are so happy that you joined us today. And this is a time where we're bummed out that we can't be together celebrating Pride in our customary fashion. But we have some cool stuff ahead to help us remember where we've come from and where we're going.
Yeah, you know, at Mission Gathering, Pride is one of our high holy days. It's a celebration not just of the LGBT inclusive community that we are, but of all of God's diversity and our commitment to justice. And that's why we're super excited to be at the Hillcrest Pride Flag and this memorial to all the work that our community has done to help embrace true inclusion and acceptance for absolutely everyone. So we're super glad you tuned in to today's worship service. And before we begin, let's open up with a word of prayer. Pastor Wendy, would you pray?
Yeah. God, we are grateful for this place, for the opportunity to connect, and for the reminder that you take us from depths and deserts and you lead us into victory and acceptance and a place of connecting with and loving and touching the lives of others. So be with us in this service. Help us to be filled with your Holy Spirit. Move in our lives. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's move into a time of musical worship.
The one I know that you'll understand to set the world in motion by reaching out for each other's hands. Maybe we'll discover what we should have known all along. Yeah, one way or another, together's where we both belong. If we listen to between us, too high to climb, too hard to break through, I know that love will lead us and find a way to bring me to you. So don't be in a hurry, think before you count us out. Oh, have to hurry. I will never let you down. If we listen to each other's hearts, we'll find we're never too far apart. And maybe love is the reason why, for the first time ever, we're seeing it.
We're seeing it eye to eye, yeah, yeah.
Seeing it eye to eye.
Seeing it eye to eye.
If we listen to each other's hearts, we'll find we're never too far.
Thank you.
knows there is no shame, there is only pride. I am loved, Father, I'm loved by you. I am loved, Father, I'm loved by you.
So as part of our Pride celebration, we wanted to take some time this morning to pray some words of something called a litany, which is an ancient form of Christian prayer, call and response, on behalf of the LGBT community and for justice in our world. So Pastor and Wendy and I will lead us through this litany, and I want to invite you on the bold parts, which you can't see, but you'll pick up the hints as we're doing it. You can join with us in praying the words, "We need you. For in our diversity, we reflect the divinity of our Creator." So after we pray a portion of text, we'll keep repeating that through this prayer as an affirmation of these truths to God. With that said, let us begin prayer.
In the beginning, God created all that is seen and unseen, every leaf and grain of sand, every living thing, large and small, every human being unique among the rest of creation, reflecting the glory and the image of our expansive Creator. And God looked upon the earth, and seeing the multiplicity of humanity, God laughed and gleefully said, "This is very good. O Creator God, you have spoken this word of truth over humanity since the very beginning. We are very good. Forgive us when we fear difference, when we minimize diversity, and when we forget that your image is only reflected within us when we live into the uniqueness of our identity. Let us remind one another,
we need you. For in our diversity, we reflect the divinity of our Creator.
O Creator God, forgive us for the ways that we have perpetuated exclusion, pushing others away from their rightful place at the table of grace, believing that unless others conform to our image of what is right and good, they are not worthy of or welcome and embrace. Let us remind one another,
we need you. For in our diversity, we reflect the divinity of our Creator.
O Creator God, forgive us for the ways that we have sought to mar your image in others and ourselves, when we have tried to change your beautiful art expressed in the face and lives of others. Help us to know deep in our bones that everyone is a divine masterpiece, just as we are. Let us remind one another,
we need you, for in our diversity we reflect the divinity of our Creator.
O Creator God, forgive us for refusing to see you in the faces of our enemies, for choosing to turn our faces away from those we do not understand, for believing that until we are all the same, we do not deserve each other's compassion. In the midst of our waywardness, reveal to us the path of grace. Let us remind one another,
we need you, for in our diversity, we reflect the divinity of our Creator.
O Creator God, help us to not believe the lies that are so often spoken over us, that we are flawed or broken because of who we are or who we love. Your love has shaped and fashioned us just as we are, and your love casts away all fear and shame. In the midst of fear and falsehood, let us remind one another,
we need you, for in our diversity, we reflect the divinity of our Creator.
O Creator God, when we have been rejected and cast aside by those who bear your name, call to our mind the truth that absolutely nothing can separate us from your love. Not churches or pastors or parents or legislation. Nothing will change your love for us, and no one can change our position before you. Let us remind one another,
we need you, for in our diversity we reflect the divinity of our Creator. At the end of time, God has promised to bring us all together, standing in our diversity on equal ground around God's banquet table, where every nation, tribe, tongue, sexuality, and gender identity will proclaim, in our vast array of language and expression, the glory of the one who has created us. There will be no more tears, nor will any division remain. We will all be one, standing in the radiant light of God's ever-shining sun. And we will know at last for certain that we have always been very good. Amen.
This is the time in our service where we take an offering. And even during this strange time of COVID, where most of our ministries are virtual, we still are doing incredible work. And so much of that happens through what you are doing with us, how we are joining together, and the fact that we can be here for Pride, and that we are reaching people that need our message of inclusion, of grace, of mercy. Pastor Brandon, you want to tell us how we can give?
Yeah. Today you can give two ways. First, on our website, if you click on the Give tab at missiongatheringsd.org, you'll be able to enter in your information there securely and give through Tithely, our online platform. You can also text the number appearing at the bottom of your screen right now. And if you do that, you can enter any dollar or cent amount and it'll be automatically deducted from your bank account. So with that said, let's pray. God, you are the giver of all good gifts. And we are grateful for the way that you sustained us individually and as a community in this season. Would you bless the gifts that are being given this morning electronically, those who will mail them in, and those who are giving in an offering of prayer or of service? God, would you take these offerings and bless them and multiply them for the expense of your community and for the broader proclamation of your radically inclusive good news? We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
What if you get the Nobel Peace Prize for curing an incredible illness? What if we found out after your pharmacological genius and your healing of this particular illness, what if we found out that you made the illness up and you actually planted and created the illness? And what if we have created an illness of separation that has allowed us to build an entire industry of reunion, only to find out we were never separated? We did this to Gentiles in the beginning. We did it to people of other religions consistently through our history. And we have certainly done this to the LGBT plus community. And I think we not only owe a severe apology, I think we owe a grand repentance to God and these people.
Good morning, Mission Gathering, and welcome as we continue in our series through the Book of Esther. Last week, Pastor Wendy walked us through chapters 3 and 4, and this week I want to continue on with chapters 5 and 6, and the message they have for us on this celebration of Pride. You know, Pride is an interesting time of year, and it's interesting that we as a church get to celebrate it as a kind of high holy day. And many straight people have asked me over the years, what is the purpose of Pride anyways? Why do LGBT people need to dance in the streets with Speedos on? Why should the church be celebrating a holiday like Pride every calendar year? And my answer has always been simple. Pride is the subversive declaration to a world that despises those who are unique and different, that they are needed. And they need to get on board or get left out of the party. It began as a riot when queer people of color grew tired of police brutality in New York and stood up for ourselves, demanding the right to freely express our uniqueness as queer people the way God created us. Soon after, it became a movement of protests throughout the country where LGBT people said that they were no longer content to live in hiding or seeking to conform to society's expectations. And as LGBT rights advanced, Pride became a celebration of progress and a constant reminder to all who refused to accept and embrace the LGBT community that nothing could keep us from living out our identities, our truths, our authentic self with joy. And today, Pride again is transforming. Pride is now expanding to a broad fight for equality, not just for queer folks, but for people of color, for women, for the differently abled, for the immigrant, and for all who face oppression. If you think about it, Pride is a celebration of the intersecting identities that we all have as children of an expansive Creator God. Pride, this celebration, is what the church is called to be. The church is the place where subversive joy is used to inspire all people to face the injustices of our world and fight for a tangible change. Yet we know in this season, so many of churches have failed to live out this mission. And this is because we have failed to recognize God's creative capacity expressed in diversity. For so long, churches have pushed aside those with different identities. Before it was LGBT, the church in America oppressed people of color. Before the church began to fight for LGBT rights, the church in America fought against women's equality. If the church is going to be the church that God is calling us to be, the body of Christ, the hands and feet of our God in the world, then we must begin to live into the values and the mission of Pride. This celebration deserves a day in our church calendar, because when we force people to hide, we not only cause tremendous harm to those people, but we open the doors for grand injustices to flourish, which is exactly the message we're going to learn from the book of Esther today. As a recap, over the past couple weeks, we've been introduced to King Xerxes. He had a queen named Vashti who refused to be objectified, so she was removed from the royal house. Then the king selected a beautiful woman named Esther to be his new queen. However, Esther was told by her uncle Mordecai that her Jewish identity should be hidden because otherwise it would disqualify her from the opportunity of being queen. So she does. Esther then is told by her uncle of a plot by a man named Haman, who's one of the king's advisors, to bring extermination to the Jewish people. Mordecai tells her that she needs to stand up, she needs to express her truest identity as a Jewish woman, and that for such a time as this, God has called her to redeem the Jewish people. Which leads us to today's text from Esther 5 and 6. Listen to this paraphrase. On the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the palace in front of the king's hall. The king was sitting on his royal throne in the hall facing the entrance. When he saw Queen Esther standing in the court, the king asked, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it will be given to you." "If it pleases the king," replied Esther, "let the king, together with Haman, come to a banquet I've prepared for them." "Bring Haman at once," the king said, "so that we may do as Esther asked." So the king and Haman went to the banquet that Esther prepared. As they were drinking wine, the king again asked Esther, "Now what is your petition? It will be given to you." Esther replied, "If the king regards me with favor, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and to fulfill my request, let the king and Haman come tomorrow to another banquet that I will prepare for them. Then I will answer the king's question." Haman went out that day happy and in high spirits. But when he saw Mordecai at the king's gate and observed that neither he rose or honored the king or Haman in his presence, Mordecai was at the receiving end of Haman's rage. Calling together his friends and his wife, Haman boasted about all the ways the king had honored him and how he elevated him above all the other nobles and officials. "And that's not all," Haman added. "I'm the only person that Queen Esther has invited to accompany the king to the banquet she's giving." "But this gives me no satisfaction," Haman said, "as long as I see that Jew Mordecai sitting at the gate." His wife said to him, "Have a poll set up and ask the king in the morning to have Mordecai impaled on it. Then go to the king and go to the banquet and enjoy yourself." This suggestion delighted Haman, so he had the poll set up. That night, the king could not sleep. So he ordered the book of the Chronicles, the record of his reign, to be brought and read to him. It was found recorded there that Mordecai had exposed two of the king's officers who had conspired to kill the king. "What honor and recognition has Mordecai received for this?" the king asked. "Nothing has been done for him," his attendants answered. Now Haman had just entered in the outer court of the palace to speak to the king about impaling Mordecai on a pole. "Bring Haman in," the king ordered. When Haman entered the king asked him, "What should be done for a man whom the king decides to honor?" Now Haman thought to himself, "Who is there that the king would rather honor except for me?" So he answered, "For the man that the king delights to honor, have them bring a royal robe that the king has worn, and place him on a horse that the king has ridden, one with the royal crest placed on its head. Then let the robe and the horse be entrusted to the king's most noble princes. Let them robe the man the king delights to honor and lead him on a horse through the city streets, proclaiming before him, 'This is what is done for the man that the king delights to honor.' Go at once," the king commanded Haman. "Get the robe and the horse and do just as you have suggested to Mordecai, the Jew." So Haman got the robe and the horse. He robed Mordecai and led him on horseback through the city streets, proclaiming, "This is what is done for the man whom the king delights in." After Mordecai returned to the king's gate, but Haman rushed home, his head covered in grief, and he told his wife and all his friends everything that had happened to him. While they were talking with him, the king's eunuchs arrived and hurried Haman away to the banquet that Esther had prepared for them. So here, we have Esther, who has decided she must do something to save her people. So she steps before the king and begins working out a plan that will keep Haman distracted and unable to carry out his plan to exterminate her people. Haman sees Mordecai, the Jew, at the king's gate, and he hates Mordecai so much that he plots to have him killed. In the midst of all of this, the king discovers that Mordecai had helped him prevent his own assassination. And so in order to reward his loyalty, he asks Haman, one of his trusted advisors, what should be done. Haman is blinded by his own hubris and his own racism, and he cannot even conceive that the king would want to honor anyone but himself. So essentially, Haman says, "King, make the one you honor royal for a day. Parade them through the city with great fanfare." And the king tells Haman, "Okay, go and do this then for Mordecai, the very man that Haman in his heart was expressing so much hatred towards, and against whom he has acted consistently so disturbingly racist." So Haman parades Mordecai through the kingdom as one whom the king has honored. And this caused him tremendous embarrassment and shame. You see, in this tale, Mordecai believes a lie that infects so many people in our world, that he is somehow better or superior to others because of his ethnicity, his identity, his status. He so despises and fears the Jewish people that he cannot even stand to see a Jewish person like Mordecai standing outside of the king's palace. Let's be clear, Mordecai has done nothing wrong. He simply exists, and his existence alone rouses the existential fear in Haman so much that he wants to kill him. And not just him, all of his people. The anti-Semitic racism of this kind was not uncommon in the ancient world, and it's not uncommon today. For thousands of years, people have been demonizing those of different races, gender expressions, religions, and sexualities. For thousands of years, the Jewish people in particular have been on the receiving end of baseless, fear-rooted hatred. The New Testament tells us that the opposite of fear is love. Love is the ability to see someone as they are and to embrace them, knowing that their diversity is a gift to help you grow and expand as an expression of God's own creativity. Others are seen as true gifts in this light. They are delights, and we cherish difference. We embrace them as they are, and we even sacrifice ourselves for their own good. That's what love is, according to the Bible. Fear, on the other hand, sees difference, and rather than being provoked to curiosity and learning, it causes the person to turn away or to seek to rid the very thing that they fear from their presence. And in this process, they often begin, out of fear, to project false narratives onto others. These false narratives rooted in fear, they are what we call prejudices. We say that Jewish people are out to do harm, but they have no evidence. And their fear turns off their rational brain. Haman has no reason to fear the Jewish people. He has no reason to fear Mordecai. But his fear and his hatred and his bias has caused him to stop thinking rationally and to start acting in a really harmful, irrational way. This is what happens when we're afraid of others, isn't it? We say that gay people are out to harm our children. We say that people of color are more prone to crime. None of these things are rational. None of them are in fact true. But when we choose fear, we choose to suspend our rationality and react with unvarnished anger. That's what fear does. Haman is afraid of difference, so he seeks to marginalize and eradicate it. Esther and Mordecai know that they live in a culture that doesn't accept them. So Esther hides her identity, and apparently Mordecai couldn't hide his identity. So he was subject to loads of discrimination, racism, homophobia, xenophobia. They aren't rational. And when people are functioning in that mental space of fear, they're not seeking to grow or learn or understand. They're seeking only to ensure that they maintain power and control and safety through the oppression and suppression of whoever they fear. The text is essentially showing us today how foolish Haman and his racism is. He's delighting at having dinner with King Esther, but he doesn't know that she's Jewish. He doesn't know, but he clearly shows that his fears or prejudices, they're not justified. He's delighting at being with the king and with Esther, and he's at once trying to express his hatred towards Esther's very own family. He also tries to go great lengths, not only to have the Jewish people killed, as we heard a couple of chapters ago, but essentially to get that one who's out front of the king's gate exterminated. But as he tries to get rid of Mordecai, as he tries to convince the king that this is what needs to happen, the king ends up flipping the script unbeknownst to him. He says, instead of following what Haman wanted and eradicating Mordecai, he says, no, we're going to elevate and celebrate Mordecai. Parade him in the streets. Let everyone know that he has the honor of the king. Haman is literally forced to serve Mordecai and to eat his own xenophobia and racism as Mordecai is proclaimed in the streets to be honored by the king. A few more notes here. Mordecai getting paraded through the streets is important. Remember that the king has already signed Haman's order to massacre the Jewish people. Now, by a series of strange events, the king is having a Jewish person lauded in the streets. In a sense, Mordecai is being outed. He's being elevated. He's being exposed to the public and protected by power. And do you know what happens when the public is exposed to someone who is different and whom they're afraid of? Their fear begins to wane. Perhaps the Jews aren't as strange after all, they begin to think. Perhaps the stereotypes and lies we believed are wrong. If the king can celebrate Mordecai, maybe we can accept Jewish people as well. In other words, there is great power in being able to stand in your true identity in public, especially in a place where the identity may not already be welcomed. And this is precisely what pride is all about. There are millions of people in our world today who believe they've never met an LGBT person, who don't even believe that we're real. But getting to march down the streets without fear and with joy and a resilient spirit forces the onlooking world to grapple with this truth that LGBT people are real, that we're worthy of love and acceptance. When we're forced to hide, it becomes easy to be demonized. It's easy for lies to spread. Fear increases. But when we step out and be proud, when we step into the light of our authenticity. We expose racism and prejudice and homophobia and hatred and bias in others. When anyone, LGBTQ or otherwise, leans into their authentic identity, it's both an invitation and encouragement to others to do the same, and a powerful way to confront the fear in the hearts of those who fear the difference. Mordecai couldn't hide who he was. His identity caused fear inside of Haman, primarily because Haman had been conditioned and had willfully adopted a racist point of view. He believed Mordecai was inferior because of his identity. But as Mordecai is paraded through the streets of the kingdom, this moment of visibility and honor begins to chip away the prejudice and discriminatory behavior of everyone who sees him. This is what coming out does. This is what living in authenticity does. Only when Mordecai and Esther refuse to be ashamed of who they are, do they have real power. Is it dangerous for them? Absolutely. Living authentically always is, especially in societies where marginalization and oppression are the operating system. But this is the paradox. When we put aside our masks and all that we use to hide who God made us to be, we unlock our power to create true reformation in our world. The more we refuse to believe that we are somehow less, that we are shameful, the less we believe that, and the more we choose to live transparently, the more we'll quench the flames of fear that burn around us. And those who benefit our oppression will, like Mordecai, walk away with their heads hung in shame. On the special celebration of Pride, the invitation to all of us is this: to work hard to create spaces where everyone can show up and be embraced in their full authenticity, even if it makes us uncomfortable, even if we don't understand it. In an era where racism is on the rise, transphobia is expressed from the highest levels of government, where poor people are treated than less than human, we need to work hard to combat this fear that fuels this xenophobia of all kinds. And all of us who feel like we might not fit in, like we're somehow flawed, or have some aspects of ourselves for which we should be ashamed, we must remember the words that Mordecai spoke to Esther last week. Perhaps for such a time as this, God has positioned us so that we, through living fully and authentically, can be used by His Spirit to bring transformation, to save others from suffering like Esther does. The call is to be brave, to trust that God knew what God was doing when they created us, that we're made just as we should be, that our authenticity is a gift to the world, and that without it, our communities, our families, our churches are missing something vital. So on this Pride, may we all commit to fighting against the fear that was in Haman's world and is in ours. May we defend those whom face the threats from people who are caught up in racism and sexism and homophobia like Haman. Those who receive fear and discrimination simply because of how God made them to be. May we combat such fear by inviting others to live authentically through our unconditional willingness to celebrate their diversity and difference. May we challenge every prejudice and bias by choosing also ourselves to live authentically and fully and freely. Because if we don't, not only does our world suffer, but so do we. So whoever you are, whatever makes you you, know that God doesn't make mistakes. Know that your true self is how you are supposed to live. And know that when you choose the brave and bold path of authenticity, you will be used by God to bring about the reformation of hearts and minds and create the more beautiful world our hearts know is possible. That is the power of Pride. Happy Pride, Mission Gathering.
We're now at the point in our service where we're going to take communion together.
So whatever elements you might have, whether that's grape juice and bread or cupcakes and water, whatever you have, we want to invite you to join in with us as we partake in this ritual with billions of other Christians around the world and throughout the ages who are gathering together each Sunday morning to remember the way that Jesus lived and the way that Jesus calls us to live. As Jesus came to the end of his life, he gathered around a table just like this with his disciples. And as his supper was beginning, Jesus picked up the bread and he blessed it. He broke it. And he looked at his disciples each in the eye and said, "This is my body. It's going to be broken for you. As often as you eat of this, remember me." Let us eat of the bread together. In the same way, as supper was coming to its end, Jesus picked up the glass of wine, and he looked at his disciples in the eyes as he blessed it, and he said, "Take and drink of this, all of you. For this is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of the sins of the world. As often as you drink of this cup, do it remembering me." Let us partake of the cup together. Would you pray with me? God, we are grateful for the gift of Jesus, the way he broke open his body and poured out his life for our forgiveness and to show us how we too might live according to your plans. God, we are so grateful for the grace that you've poured out on us and for our ability today to recommit ourselves once again to breaking open our lives, pouring them out to bring healing and redemption to our world just as Jesus did. So God, we gather with the saints around the world and throughout the ages today and praise you for your love and for the gift of Jesus in our lives. God, would you move in our hearts over this next week? Would you help us to perceive your presence? And would you help us continue to be faithful followers of this radical way of love? God, we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
True colors are beautiful.
like a rainbow.
Oh, like a rainbow.
Who can't remember when I last saw you laughing? You crazy, and you've taken all you can bear. Just call me up, 'cause I will always be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true.
Tell you just a little bit about what we have coming up at Mission Gathering. We have our Wednesday night contemplative service that happens at 6 p.m. That's by Zoom invitation, but it's open to everybody. We keep that private for reasons of prayer and connection, but again, everybody is welcome at that. We have Pastor Brandon's Thursday night Roman study, which is apparently going to be going on for a long time.
Yes.
Tell us.
At 6 p.m. you can join. That's also a Zoom invitation thing, but you go to our website, click on Thursday Bible study under small groups, and you can register. You'll get an invitation for the Zoom, and we'd love to have you.
And then we also have a Roots class coming up, and that's for anybody who's new to Mission Gathering and want to know more about who we are, what we believe, and what we're focused on. And that'll be August 2nd at 11:30 a.m.
Right after the service. Again, if you're new, whether in San Diego or anywhere else in the world, this is a great opportunity to learn about our values, our beliefs, our history, and how you can stay connected during COVID-19 and after this pandemic is over. So we hope that you'll sign up for that on missiongatheringsd.org.
And then we've got a guest for benediction.
Yes, and so today, in order to do benediction special for our Pride celebration, I'm really excited to have Mpo Tutu, who is the daughter of Desmond Tutu. She's an out lesbian woman, also a minister living in Amsterdam with her wife. I had the opportunity to meet with her a couple years ago when I was traveling, and I was talking to her to do a benediction for San Diego Pride's parade, and she sent a couple of them, so I'm excited to be able to include one of her benedictions to end our Pride service today. So with that said, we're really grateful for you tuning in today. We hope you're having an incredible Pride celebration, albeit a socially distanced and virtual one. And with that said, here is our benediction from Reverend Mpo Tutu.
I bless you and all of us who join in this celebration with gratitude for how far we have come and strength for how far we have yet to go. I bless each of us with courage to stand up and speak out for those who cannot stand up or speak out for themselves. I bless each of us with impatience
at injustice.
I bless each of us with the hope that each of us can live the full truth of who we are. I bless in the name of each transgender woman who has been harried, or murdered, or injured for who she is. For each person of color who is still cowering in a closet because standing up and being out can mean death. I bless each of us with the joyful celebration of who we are. And I bless each of us with the courage to become the best of